بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله العظيم من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهدي الله تعالى فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له له الملك وله الحمد يحيي ويميت وهو حي لا يموت بيده الخير وهو على كل شيء قدير وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله وصفيه وخليله أدى الأمانة وبلغ الرسالة ونصح للأمة وكشف الغمة وتركنا على المحجة البيضاء ليلها كنهارها لا يزيغ عنها إلا هالك فعليه أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم وعلى آله وصحبه ومن استنى بسنته إلى يوم الدين اللهم اجعلنا منهم ومن الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر آمين يا رب العالمين وأوصيكم ونفسي بتقوى الله عز وجل وقد أمرنا بالحق وقال تعالى يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون وقال سبحانه يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما ثم أما بعد We begin by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by bearing witness that none has the right to be worshipped or unconditionally obeyed except for him. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to send his peace and blessings upon his messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We bear witness that he was sent as a guide to mankind, that his sunnah is the way to live, that he is the best of all creation. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to send his peace and blessings upon his companions and his family and those that follow until the day of judgment. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us amongst them. Allahumma ameen. Dear brothers and sisters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says something very interesting in the Qur'an. He highlights the behavior of man, the behavior of man when it comes to the changes that take place in his life. And usually when we talk about the concepts of gratitude, when we talk about the concepts of patience, when we talk about those types of things, we mention them in regards to major things. So for example, we talk about the concept of having gratitude, you know, whenever something big happens to you. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you a huge opening, a new job or some amount of wealth or some gift or you know a new wife or a new husband in the situation of the sisters, whatever it is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you something big, so then you will be reminded, say alhamdulillah, thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, be grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right, but as far as the small everyday things in life, we don't really talk about it much. So we don't talk about the concept of gratitude or we don't implement gratitude in our lives for the ability to come to the masjid, although that is huge. For the ability to talk, for the ability to walk, you know, for having enough food to feed you tonight rather than looking at a major salary. And the Prophet ﷺ says, "Man la yashkur bil qaleel, la yashkur bil kathir." Whoever does not thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the small things, will not be able to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the major things. Likewise, when we talk about patience, the only time you'll hear about patience is when you lose your job, is whenever someone dies in your family, right? Something really major happens in your life. Then we start to remind each other, have sabr, be patient, say, inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. And the problem is that that's like telling someone who has never lifted weights to pick up 500 pounds at one time, all of a sudden. Your entire life, your everyday life, reflects no form of patience whatsoever. But then all of a sudden, when something bad happens, you think you're going to be able to pull yourself together and have patience. So implementing these two things in our lives, in the daily aspects of our lives, for the smaller things in life, truly requires a certain type of attitude. It requires a behavior pattern. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Qur'an about how people generally think and operate. وَأَمَّا الْإِنسَانُ إِذَا مَبْتَلَاهُ رَبُّهُ فَأَكْرَمَهُ وَنَعَمَهُ فَيَقُولُ رَبِّي أَكْرَمًا As for the human being, أَمَّا الْإِنسَانُ وَمَا سُمِّيَ الْإِنسَانُ إِلَّا لِنَسِيهِ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the name insan here, this forgetful creation. Whenever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tests him, مَبْتَلَى فَأَكْرَمَهُ وَنَعَمَى Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives him bounty and gives him honor. Right? This is all we search for in life. We look for reputation, we look for wealth. At the end of the day, this is what usually people are toiling after. Reputation and wealth. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, this person, when he's tested, مَبْتَلَاهُ رَبُّ فَأَكْرَمَهُ وَنَعَمَى And it's very interesting here, the word usage, the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the very start tells us that this is a test. Your wealth is a test. Your honor is a test. Your reputation is a test. Everything that's been given to you of good is a test. And in fact, it's even more severe of a test. Because Ata rahimahullah said, Al-ibtila' bin-na'im aqsa wa ashad min al-ibtila' bid-diqi wal-faqr. To be tested with good things is much worse than being tested with bad things. Because when you're being tested with good things, you don't realize that you're being tested. You're completely oblivious to the fact that this is a test. The na'im that you have is a test. The blessing you have is a test. The money that you have is a test. It's all a test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if you're not grateful for what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving you, you're failing that test even if the na'im has not been taken away from you yet. Because you know what that's like? That's like your subhanAllah, you think of a person who's walking and he's about to fall into a trap. The more you build his expectations, the harder the fall will be. The harder the fall will be. So you should actually feel sorry for that person who has but does not think. Because very, very, very soon, whether it's here or whether it's in the hereafter, something is going to hit him and he's going to lose it all and he won't know how to deal with it. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِذَا مَبْتَلَاهُ رَبُّهُ فَأَكْرَمَهُ وَنَعَمَ But when everything is good, when he's got his money, when he's got his wealth, when he has his honor, when he has everything the way that he wants to have it, فَيَقُولُ رَبِّي أَكْرَمًا He says, my Lord has been generous to me. He's not saying it as a form of gratitude. He's saying it as a form of boastfulness. As a form of boasting. You know, wallahi, I remember once speaking to a brother who sold alcohol, sold khamr. And we went to him and we tried to advise him to come to the masjid. And he said, me? He said, رَبِّي بِحِمْنِي My Lord loves me. Says, MashaAllah, I own this house, I own this many cars, Allah gave me kids, my wife never had a miscarriage, we have 8 kids, MashaAllah, they're all living wealthy. My Lord loves me. So SubhanAllah, he says it as a form of boastfulness. My Lord loves me. رَبِّي أَكْرَمَهُ وَأَمَّا إِذَا مَبْتَلَاهُ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that same individual, مَبْتَلَاهُ The same person. فَقَدَرَ عَلَيْهِ رِزْقَهُ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala just restrains a little bit as well. Allah restrains it. Now qadr, the meaning of the word qadr is to restrain, to restrict. One of the reasons why Laylatul Qadr is called Laylatul Qadr, as the scholar Sayyid Imam al-Qushayri rahimahullah says, because of the amount of angels that are roaming on the night of al-Qadr, there is no space for them. SubhanAllah, because of the amount of angels, of malaika. يعني تضيق الأرض everything السماء والأرض becomes very very restrictive so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not say I put this person in poverty قدر عليه رزقا his wealth was restrained it was restricted it was less than before فيقول ربي أهانا he blames Allah the same person he looks and he says my Lord is humiliating me why is God doing this to me Why is God doing that to me? The same person that's selling alcohol, the same person that's living his life in haram, the same person that's dealing in riba, the same person that's not being grateful, he now looks to Allah. He never once said, why me? In the sense, why me? For the good things that Allah gave me. Why did Allah choose me out of all people to give me this na'im? We all know that we all have our roots in different countries. Most of us have our roots in different countries and the turmoil that's in those countries. Why me? Why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala choose me to live in this blessing? To be able to live in safety. Why me? We don't say that. But when things start happening wrong, then all of a sudden, why is God doing this to me? You automatically blame Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now when things are good, it's okay. Everything's fine. You know, even in the two people in Surah Al-Kahf that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, the man with the two gardens who's being advised and things of that sort. He says, you know, I don't think any of this is going away. I don't think the hour is coming close anyway. You know, I think I'm still a young guy. I still have all these things. Everything is going fine. وَلَئِنْ رُدِدْتُ إِلَىٰ رَبِّي And even if I go back to Allah, then I'll probably find better than what I have here. He took the sign of good in his life, despite the gratitude, as a sign that God was pleased with him. And that's a very dangerous thing to do. Very dangerous thing to do. Because sometimes what you have been given is a punishment for you. وَلَا تُعْجِبْكَ أَمْوَالُهُمْ وَأَوْلَادُهُمْ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, do not be fascinated. Don't be fascinated by their wealth and by their children. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ لِيُعَذِّبَهُمْ بِهَا Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to punish them with that. Can you imagine? That same person who would say, my Lord loves me because things are going well. Who can afford to live the good life and spoil his child and things of that sort. And then his child at the age of 18 walks up to his father and says, shut up dad, I don't want to hear anything you have to say. And he pushes him out of the way and he says, you know what? You don't own me. I'm a grown man now. I'm an adult. That's adab. That's punishment. Wallahi, that's punishment. Or a person who did not raise his daughter with the concept of al-hishma and modesty and hijab. And then after all you've given her, at the age of 19, 20, she goes and she runs off and she, you know, leaves you for some guy or something of that sort. That's a punishment for you. That's adab. Subhanallah. You know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is punishing them. And if you really think about it, the most miserable people on the face of the earth are the rich and the famous. The richest ones and the most famous ones. Think about it, subhanAllah. You watch all of the, you know, you see all of these different TV shows and things of that sort where you see these characters and you know that at the end of the day they're going to get a paycheck. You know, they had that show about Raymond and things of that sort. And I think he was making $7 million per episode. Wow. You know, after every episode, they go home with their big fat check. But at the same time, these are the same people that are most likely to commit suicide or be found in a bathtub in some hotel room. The same people. Allah, they have wealth. They have fame. They sold their souls for the fame. Their entire lives, they sold their souls for it. But now, you know, they'll go crazy. They'll start to use hard drug after hard drug after hard drug. And then after that, subhanAllah, you know, I remember there was once an interview with one of these celebrities that said, the only thing I want in life is to be able to go out with my daughter and get an ice cream cone without anyone in my face. Hey, subhanAllah, you got into this field, you killed yourself for this field, and now the only thing I want is to be able to go with my daughter and get an ice cream cone and not be bothered. What happened here? It was adab. It was punishment. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions to us in two ayat that are in two subsequent surahs. It's amazing. In one ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَلَمَّا نَسُوا مَا ذُكِّرُوا بِهِ Whenever, in Surah Al-An'am, whenever they forgot what they were reminded of, they turned their backs, they were reminded time after time after time, and they kept on turning their backs. Now, what do you think Allah is going to do? Is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala going to send a tornado to his house? Is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala going to turn the ground on him? Is Allah, what is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala going to do to him? فَتَحْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ أَبْوَابَ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ We open for them the doors of everything. This is what you want? Take it. You think this is what's going to make you happy? You think this is purpose? Take it. Here is your salary. Here is the wealth. Here's the status. Here's the house that you wanted. You wanted to buy your house on riba so bad. You got your fatwa. Here's your house. Go ahead. Take it all. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is punishing you with that. حَتَّى إِذَا فَرِحُوا بِمَا أُوتُوا Until they became pleased with what they have. أَخَذْنَاهُ بَغْتَةً We snatch them all of a sudden. فَإِذَا هُمْ مُبْلِسُونَ So they are in a state of utter despair. SubhanAllah. They thought they had it all. Everything was open to them. But it was a punishment. It was a drug. You know, subhanAllah, one of the worst things about a drug is with every single drug, you're not satisfied. You want the next drug. Until you'll kill yourself because you've run out of drugs. Dunya is a drug. Because the Prophet ﷺ says, لو أعطي ابن آدم واد من ذهب, if the son of Adam is given a valley of gold, you imagine someone gives you a valley of gold? What would he do? لبتغى به ثانية. He's going to want another one. And if he's given two, he's going to want three. He never gets satisfied. It's a punishment. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Ma'idah, He says something very similar, but not in the form of punishment. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَوْ أَنَّ أَهْلَ الْقُرَىٰ آمَنُوا وَاتَّقَوْا And had the people of the city believed and had taqwa, لَفَتَحْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ بَرَكَاتٍ مِّنَ السَّمَاءِ وَالْأَرْضِ The same words, just one word is added. We would have opened for them the blessings, the barakah of the heavens and the earth. It would have all been opened for them as a form of reward, not as a form of punishment. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not just talking about akhirah, Allah's talking about dunya here too. And that's when we really start to understand what it means, رَبَّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَا فِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنَا Yes, we all want to be happy in dunya and in akhirah. Let's face it. Let's not fool ourselves and say that we are all, mashallah, zuhad. We all, you know, it's funny. I always love it whenever people say we all live in America for da'wah. Yeah, mashallah. All of us are here for da'wah. Let's not kid ourselves. We're here to have better lives. That's why our parents came here for second generation, and that's why many of us came here for your first generation, not to do da'wah. Very few people. Maybe I don't want to wrong anyone. Some people did. But the vast majority of Muslims in America have come for a better life, and that's okay. That's okay. But here's the thing. How are you going to pursue that dunya? And what do you want from this dunya? You want comfort, you can have comfort. The Prophet ﷺ also made dua to that effect. In fact, more specific than رَبَّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَةً The Messenger of Allah ﷺ from his dua, وَوَسِّعْلِي فِي دَارِي Grant me expanse in my home. Now was the Prophet, we know who the Prophet ﷺ is. You think that the Prophet ﷺ could not just announce to the companions one day, you know, these hujurat are getting very, very, very small, these apartments are very small. Even when I make sujood, in Qiyamul Layl, I have to tap the legs of Aisha radiallahu anha to move her legs. My house is very small. There's actually, in one of the narrations, it's a Hassan narration. SubhanAllah, someone actually measured the house of the Prophet ﷺ, and I think it was 9 yards by 4. Talk about square footage. Now SubhanAllah, you think the Prophet ﷺ could not have come out and said, I want a bigger house? Okay, then why didn't he do that? If he's saying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَسِعْلِ فِي دَارِي Was he asking for Allah to send down an ayah in the Qur'an to command him to move into a kingdom or to magically increase his house? What was the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asking for? وَسِعْلِ فِي دَارِي To grant me a feeling of expansion in my home. To not feel suffocated by the dunya. Because let's face it, dunya is suffocating. It's restricting. It drives you insane. No matter what you have, you're never satisfied. No matter how much Allah gives you, you're still craving more. It's a drug. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, if this is all you have, وَمَنْ أَعْرَضَ عَنْ ذِكْرِي فَإِنَّ لَهُ مَعِيشَةً ضَنْكًا Literally, ضَنْكًا, literally, you know when they say the walls are closing on you. The walls are closing on you. And also in the famous hadith, or the famous incident where Rab'i ibn Amir radiallahu ta'ala anhu went to Ar-Rustum. And he said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ ابْتَعَثَنَا لِنُخْرِجَ الْعِبَادِ مِنْ عِبَادَةِ الْعِبَادِ إِلَىٰ عِبَادَةِ رَبِّ الْعِبَادِ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent us to take people from the servitude, the worship of other slaves, or the slavery of other slaves to the slavery of the Lord of all slaves. What's the next thing he said? وَمِنْ ضِيقِ الدُّنْيَا إِلَىٰ سَعْتِ الْآخِرَةِ From the constriction of this dunya to the vastness of the akhirah. SubhanAllah. From the vastness of the akhirah. When you have purpose, when you have barakah in what Allah has given you, blessing, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes it easier to take. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows you to start seeing the good in everything. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes you an optimistic person. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala writes for you happiness even in quote-unquote miserable situations. And I'll give you an example.
Sometimes we don't realize the blessing of what we already have because we don't say, why me? When good comes to us, we only say, why me? When bad things happen. And the test of an na'im is a shukr. The test of blessing is shukr. Sometimes brothers say, I want to know, is Allah testing me? Are you grateful for what you have? Then inshallah ta'ala, this is a good thing. This is a reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Just keep on being grateful. But you know, subhanAllah, I want you to just imagine this incident. Envision this for a moment. Let's say that you just had the worst day of your life. You had, you know, a bad day at work. You had a fight with your wife on the phone. And then you got in the car, you had to go pick up your child from school. And you're just miserable. You're having a terribly bad day. Let's say that your child on the way out, when he put his book sack in the trunk, he slammed the trunk so hard that he hurt the car. He scratched the car. What are you going to say to your child? You're going to yell and scream, right? If you like your car a little bit too much, if you're obsessed, because we have a tendency in America to personify things. If you have a special name for your car, a pet name for your car, you'll come out and you'll say, are you okay? To your car, and you'll yell at your son. You'll want to beat your son. I hope none of you will beat your son for that. But subhanAllah, it'll just make your day more miserable. Now let's say that your son came to the car. And alhamdulillah, he was a good boy. He put his book sack in the back seat. He sat in the car, but you're just having a bad day. And then your car flipped over and you had an accident. And you managed to escape your car. And as you're escaping your car, you realize that your son is still in the car. Do you care about your car at all at that point? Are you thinking to yourself, oh no, the hubcap, the rims, it got scratched. Are you thinking of that? No. I just want my son. You see, Allah gave you. You just weren't realizing it. SubhanAllah, Allah gave us. We're not realizing it. And it became a test. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us this beautiful quality of a shukr and thankfulness and gratitude. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us for our heedlessness. Allahumma ameen. Aqulu qawli hadha wa astaghfirullah li wa lakum wa lisa'il muslimin. فاستغفروا إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين والعاقبة للمتقين. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على عبدك ورسولك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. Dear brothers and sisters, it is for this reason that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَئِن شَكَرْتُمْ لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ. And if you are grateful, I will increase you. لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ وَلَئِن كَفَرْتُمْ إِنَّ عَذَابِي لَشَدِيدٌ. If you turn away, then know that my punishment is severe. This ayah is such a magnificent ayah. Because what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tell us right off the bat? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, it's not necessarily increase that will make you increase in gratitude. But if you increase in gratitude, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will increase you in everything else. You might be given the whole world, but you still won't be grateful. But if you have the quality of gratitude, you will naturally feel increase in everything. And Allah left it open. لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not say, I will increase you in money, or I will increase you in this. No, He left it open. لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ. And if you read the tafsir, the interpretations of this ayah, they're so beautiful. Some of the scholars says it means honor. Some of the scholars said it means your wealth, it means property. Some of the scholars said it means your status in akhirah. At the end of the day, one thing we can come to a conclusion, it means all of those things. La azidannakum. Just be grateful. And you will feel the increase in everything. Wala in kafartum, inna adhabi la shadeed. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not say, and if you're ungrateful, that wa'adhi. لَوَعَذِّبَكُمْ or I'm going to punish you, or لَوَعَذِّبَنَّكُمْ. No. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ عَذَابِي لَشَدِيدٌ. This is the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Know that my punishment is severe. Not that I'm going to punish you. Know that my punishment is severe. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala leaves the door open always, in subtle ways, al-latif. He leaves the way open for you. You know, even in Surah Al-Buruj, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He talks about those who killed the people of the ditch. ثُمَّ لَمْ يَتُوبُوا ثُمَّ لَمْ يَتُوبُوا فَلَهُمْ عَذَابٌ شَدِيدٌ. And then they don't repent. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala leaves open the door even for criminals. And Imam Hassan al-Basri rahimahullah, he says, subhanallah, قَتَلُوا أَوْلِيَاء, they killed the awliya, the most beloved of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَهُوَ يَدْعُوهُمْ إِلَى الْكَرَمِ وَالْجُودِ, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is calling them to generosity and benevolence. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is calling them to good. Allah always leaves the door open for you. And that in and of itself is something that we need to be grateful for. But again, that incident, dear brothers, that hypothetical incident that I just mentioned to you, driving, you know, on the way back from school. Many of you may remember the tornadoes that hit Joplin, Missouri. Joplin, Missouri, very recently, about a year ago, was destroyed by tornadoes. And I remember, subhanAllah, CNN was interviewing all these different people. And obviously, the job of the newscaster is to evoke emotion. He tries to get the most newsworthy news, basically, the thing that's going to attract people. So even if it's complete nonsense, they're going to try to get what's going to catch the attention of the viewer. So what did they do? They'll go stand with these people in front of their destroyed homes. And they'll say, how do you feel about what's happened to you? I mean, you ask someone the same day or a day after they just lost everything that they had, how do you feel or what do you want to say? You're obviously trying to get them to cry. You're trying to get them to fall apart. And then once they start falling apart, the camera will zoom in on your face, show your tears. They're not interested in what's really wrong with you. It's just trying to get the most newsworthy news. So how do you feel? And I remember, subhanAllah, because sometimes we can truly learn lessons from those who don't have Islam, but sometimes have impulses based on fitrah. Sometimes they act upon their fitrah even though they're not Muslims. There is one woman who was holding her 2-year-old baby. And she said, today is the happiest day of my life. Why is that, you know? She said, because when the tornado hit, my daughter started to fly away. And I grabbed her by the arms, and I held her, and I thought I was going to lose her. And when it was all said and done, she was still in my arms, and she was still alive. So I never appreciated her, or the blessing of her, until this day. SubhanAllah. Non-Muslim doesn't say, La ilaha illallah Muhammadan Rasulullah, but has an impulse on fitrah. Just think about what Allah has given you and say Alhamdulillah for what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you. Because no matter what you say, no matter how bad your day is, you know, sometimes, subhanAllah, we will lose our tempers because our cell phones fell into some water or broke. 200 years ago, the king of the world, or the greatest king in the world, wouldn't even have had a cell phone. SubhanAllah. And we'll lose our minds for that, we'll start to get upset, we'll start to yell, we'll start to scream, we'll start to go into a fit. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us enough to be thankful for, enough to say Alhamdulillah for. And Sheikh Imam Abu Ishaq from Egypt, he said something very beautiful once. He said, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, allows you to say Alhamdulillah, that's enough to thank Him for. Because there's actually a hadith where Dawood alayhi salam was saying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that, you know, I even feel like I need to thank you. Say Alhamdulillah for the ability to say Alhamdulillah. Thanking Allah for the ability to say thank you, basically. So he said, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then allows you to, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows you to die saying Alhamdulillah, let's say that you leave this world saying Alhamdulillah, you still owe Allah a Alhamdulillah for the one that you said before you died. Allah still gave you you're still in debt. Even if you've paid off Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for everything and it's impossible to do so. Hypothetically speaking, you've said Alhamdulillah for every blessing in your life. The hundreds of processes or thousands that take place in your body for you and I to function right now. Even those of you who are sleeping in the khutbah, hundreds of functions going on in your body to say Alhamdulillah for. If Allah allows you to die saying Alhamdulillah, then you still die in debt. Because you have to say Alhamdulillah for the ability to die saying Alhamdulillah. That's gratitude. That's when you start to think, when you start to analyze, and then you feel blessed. You realize your situation. And you have self-worth. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala elevates you thereby in this dunya and the akhirah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us patience and gratitude in all situations of our lives. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not to make the blessings that come upon us a means of punishment, but rather a means of blessing. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that when hardship comes to us, it is not a manifestation of His punishment, but rather it's a manifestation of His reward and His means of elevating us. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us amongst those who look for every opportunity to draw close to Him. اللهم اغفر للمؤمنين والمؤمنات والمسلمين والمسلمات الأحياء منهم والأموات إنك سميع قريب مجيب الدعوات. اللهم اغفر لنا وارحمنا واعف عنا ولا تعذبنا. ربنا ظلمنا أنفسنا وإن لم تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكونن من الخاسرين. اللهم إنك عفو تحب العفو فاعف عنا. اللهم اغفر لوالدينا رب ارحمهما كما ربونا صغار. ربنا هب لنا من أزواجنا وذرياتنا قرة أعين وجعلنا للمتقين إماما. اللهم انصر المستضعفين في مشارق الأرض ومغاربها. اللهم انصر المستضعفين في مشارق الأرض ومغاربها. اللهم انصر المستضعفين في الشام. اللهم انصر المستضعفين في الصومال. اللهم انصر المستضعفين في باكستان. اللهم انصرهم في العراق. اللهم انصرهم في الشيشان. اللهم انصرهم في أفغانستان. اللهم انصرهم في كل مكان. اللهم عليك بعدوهم. اللهم أهلك الظالمين بالظالمين واخرجنا من بينهم سالمين. عباد الله، إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. فاذكروا الله يذكركم واشكروه على نعمائه يزد لكم ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون. وأقيم الصلاة.